Greetings and salutations to all you folks out there. I've got a game for you today on the map Canis. This is going to be a 5 versus 5, and I have been informed that it is pretty freaking epic with a lot of unusual stuff in it, so I'm going to catch absolutely as much as I possibly can of this action. I do have to warn you ahead of time, though, I am slightly behind on my recording schedule, and I am going on 3 hours of sleep from last night, so if I get a little bit of loopy in this cast, well, I apologize, but hopefully it'll up the entertainment value for you. All right, let's go ahead and introduce the teams and see where this game takes us. We've got ICOM. Ooh, I just realized that I do not have my settings enabled for constant names. That's okay, I'll get over it. We've got ICOM taking Cybern on the north side. This is going to be Frankie Darlmino. That is an interesting name. He is going for UEF. Then we've got Artifacts as Cybern. We've got Big Bang. He is taking Seraphim. And then finally, Q Continuum as UEF. That's going to be our north side team. Looks like they're all going for fairly standard-ish builds. We've got an Air Factory first for the Cybern player, but other than that, everything looks pretty much hunky-dory. Looks like we got air going down in a big, big way for Q Continuum. On the south side, let's check in. We've got BRS with two. He is going Cybern. Then on the front here, we've got Akanubis, emphasis on noob, going Seraphim in the green color. Then we've got Momo Uchina. He is taking Cybern as well. Headphone guy, DB, whatever I'm supposed to call him. I never figured that out, and apparently he hates being called headphone guy, but I'm going to carry on with it because that's the easiest thing that I can come up with for that. That is going to be Aeon for the faction of choice in the back slot. And then we've got Seraphim for Gas Pumper, holding down the right-hand side. Looks like, once again, these are relatively standard builds. We do have first land factories down for everybody. Double land, triple land for Gas Pumper, who is apparently going to be pushing out an enormous quantity of units. Maybe artillery, bridging over to the edge. We will not know until those units start a-flowing. As always, Canis has a fair bit of reclaim. All of these rocks out here mixed in with the trees. You do want to get a bunch of engineers out very, very soon. You can tech up your home mass extractors. You got four here that are very protected so that you can get one or two TMD down and protect them from pretty much everything that could be shot at them. And yeah, you tech up, not necessarily turtle up, and you get to the big slug matches at the end. Canis usually goes for some epic plays a little bit later on in the game time. We do have a mech marine, a very, very brave little mech marine. He is going to try to skirt that ACU and unfortunately going to take a plasma blast to the face. Not exactly the best way to start out your day. Then we have a couple of stealth Selens. These guys are going to park on the outside edges of the map, gather a little bit of intel on key passages. This guy is going to have radar coverage of the neck, see any units that are coming through it. He's going to have the water in the middle, and then this little guy here is probably going to park there and keep tabs on this pass. You do not want to wander too close to an ACU because, of course, the Omni from the ACU will reveal the Selen, and then he will die a horribly agonizing, painful, and yet somewhat quick death. So you do kind of want to be strategic about where you park those little guys. And my goodness, there are Selens every freaking where from the South team. There is an Air Scout as well, so intel is the name of the game for the South side, and I do not blame them one little bit. There's an artillery piece. Too bad he's not going for the Hydro. He could probably kill it before that ACU would pay attention. Who knows? Maybe not. Here comes a bomber taking out an expansioneer there. That was the first kill. Maybe he'll pick up a couple of more. We'll just have to see. An Aurora wandering a little bit too far from home, going to encounter two or three strikers there. Not the best matchup when that happens. That's two kills, looking for the third on that bomber for a veterancy, and it looks like we are going after the power engineer. Oh, sniping it off right before that one is completed. There's a little bit of a hover bomb, and four more engineers. Good lord, 7 kills on that bomber. He has definitely paid for himself, and down he goes. Help me, Big Bang saying. Artie, well, shouldn't have started an ACU upgrade with no combat units to support. Thankfully, good old Artifacts is going to be there to back his buddy up, snipe that artillery off, and prevent him from losing that Hydra, which, yeah, he actually did get a substantial amount of damage done to that thing before that artillery went down. Nice, nice moves. Okay, so we do have some more artillery moving across, which is unfortunately going to plow directly into the ACU. No problem there. A couple of free veterancy points, and not much else done. On the south side, looks like we have a couple of strikers trying to wander into the base, but hey, there's Mantis in the way. Strikers versus Mantis. I can't help, every time I think about the Striker versus Mantis, I think about like a shotgun versus a bug horde. Something like, Starship Troopers? Yes, Starship Troopers. That's the movie I'm thinking of. Anyway, yeah, random brain tangents. That's what happens when you don't have enough sleep. Looks like Momo Ushila is trying to get down a T1 point defense. Not really enough tanks there to merit a point defense, I don't think, and ACU should be able to handle that quite nicely. One way or the other, he is going to engage. And then we've got a little bit of a push from Artifacts, who does not have a gun upgrade or any other upgrade for that matter. And he's versus an unupgraded Seraphim commander, but he is going to mop up those engineers, prevent whatever little bit of reclaiming was going on there. You know, anytime you can kill an engineer, it's probably a good idea to do. And then he is going to just kind of face off here for a minute. He will eventually have to head back towards the water because the Akanubis does have supporting land factories and point defense going down. But he is just going to kind of chill out and trade blows for just a little bit. Checking back on the homeland, looks like we've got several T2 mass extractors for everybody. We've got two there. We've got none for Akanubis, who is apparently just getting his factories online and doing other things besides upgrading his mass extractors. There's one. I want to see how much of a mastall that is. Holy crap, 64 mastall. Why are you doing that to yourself, man? Why? That is no fun whatsoever. And then Q Continuum is about to drop his fourth. It looks like everybody just about is on four on the south side and looking about the same on the north as well. Well, there's three there. So Q Continuum does have the advantage of this extra reclaim on this side and some more mass extractors, though, so he doesn't necessarily have to be quite so worried about getting those mechs teched up back at home. We do have two Mantis on this side that were able to kill off an engineer there, prevent a mass extractor from building, and of course just basically be a pain in the butt all the way around, just like Cybern always is. And then on the middle marker here, we've got a little bit of a combined assault. We've got units from two players meeting up in the neck. Looks like that is a lot of supporting units from Artifacts. He is just kind of chilling out with his ACU here. What on earth? Big Bang. Ah, Big Bang started a point defense. There we go. And he is finishing it with his T1 build suite. Not exactly the most efficient use of economy and build power, but whatever floats your boat. Looks like these guys are going to partake in a very successful early push. We do have an ACU in the past, but this is the lethal number of tanks by a fairly wide little margin. It is going to be helped by the fact that this is a little later in the game. He's got access to overcharge, and this is a fairly narrow neck. Oh, that would be beautiful. 6-kill overcharge, but nope, we're just going to go for the single tank. That's cool, too. It still caused a death. Whether or not it's worth the 5,000 power that went into it is a decision that needs to be made by that player. But whatever floats your boat. Looks like, my goodness, I'm having trouble with the names. I should probably turn that on, but I really don't want to pull up the menu screen in the middle of a game. Akanubis did get forced into the water by the combined assault from these two ACUs. Looks like we got point defense going down from the T2 comm. And yeah, that is a bad time for everybody. He is about to lose his energy storage as well, so bye-bye overcharge. Looks like we've got, what is that? Minus 34. What the crap? Is that chrono dampener? That might be chrono dampener. We'll just have to check back and see what is happening with that commander. Cannot mercy, too much air. Yeah. There's paint coming in from the back. Definitely got a higher count of interceptors. And the middle is not looking good at the moment at all. Holy crap. We've got a horde of about 25 Mantis pushing through. Is that 25? I need to get better at my random guessing. 20! Sorry. Guessing high. 20 Mantis moving towards the base. Thankfully, there are some hoplites moving over from the left. It looks like Momo Uchiha is going to try to protect his teammate's base. Hopefully, he doesn't walk slam into the Mantis with the hoplites, which looks like about what's going to happen. You don't have the HP for that. Stop. Okay, good. So he is running once again. Hopefully, he will be able to make a difference there. Blue push, says Artifacts. Yes. See, this is the problem when you're facing a T1 rush. Basically, they have so many units that even if you have superior tech, you can't kill them all, and there's too many units, and your ACU can only be in one spot at a time. It creates massive logistical problems, which is basically the summation of what you want to do in every RTS game. You want to force logistics problems onto the other person, and at the moment, that also is going to involve economy, because ICOM is about to pillage and plunder the... Is that a repetitive redundancy? I think that is a repetitive redundancy. The left side expansion for BRS Watu, who is still on the bottom of the scoreboard at the moment, so not exactly the person that should be picked on, but whatever. Eliminating a player is eliminating a player. We do have Momo Uchila coming out of the water. There is a T2 point defense about to go down, but he does have access to overcharge, I do believe, so he will be able to overcharge that thing. Fire Beetle! Oh! Let me just casually walk up here with a Fire Beetle that has come all the way from the factory and just detonate it next to your ACU, because that sounds like a fun time, right? There's another Fire Beetle coming up, but it is going to encounter Thams. It is going to take some Thams with it when it goes, but it is still going to encounter Thams. And now here is Akanubis training blows with two ACUs. This is a convoluted mess in the middle here. I don't think I've ever seen anything this confusing. Frankie yelling, block him! Block him! Keep him from getting to the water! Well, yeah, that's a good plan, but when you've got 90% land scouts, why is that? There's like... Or there were, until they started dying. There was about 8 land scouts in the front there. It's like a 1-to-1 ratio with tanks. I'm not sure what that's all about. Akanubis is... Oh, 350! No! Akanubis is out of the game. That is Commander down at the 11-minute mark. That is... Oh. Fire Beetles? Hello. That was a premature detonation. Snicker. And, yeah, all of that is going to be a waste, and the hoplites are going to go down to the commanders as well. So the South team was already in a tough spot, and now it is going to be even harder to defend. They've actually got blue units pushing in almost completely in the left side. Lost the Master Extractor right over there for BRS with two. They've lost the entire mid. They do have a firm grasp on the right-hand side, and it looks like Gas Pumper is going to be teching up. He's already got a T2 power generator down, and he's got gun and T2 on his commander, so that is a nasty Rambo comm on that side. But for the rest of the map, this is looking like a losing battle, honestly. There are so many hoplites being produced by Momo Uchila, but I hate to see that because it seems like he keeps running them into units. He is going to dodge back from the commander there. High alpha damage makes for an awesome preemptive strike against a commander, but you do have to get those son of a guns out of the way once they fire. I think it's 8 seconds, 7.5 seconds, something like that, in between the firing cycle. You basically want to run away and then run back to deliver another payload of explosives. Looks like Momo Uchila is going to stay on the neck here, fighting against these tanks moving in. We do have T2 hover tanks. Riptides may not be the best in mass-to-mass comparisons versus other tanks, but they're very speedy and they can cross the water at any point where they damn well please. So they are very handy tanks to have around. Stick them up the backside where they are definitely not intended to go, and then you've got pillar main tanks guarding the landbound side of the map. Not a bad way to go, honestly. We do have a Jester shooting over to the left side. Not sure what he can accomplish when he has this incredibly large group of interceptors that are not going to pursue him. You know what? That's totally fine. He could die to a flak. That is absolutely a-okay. Looks like Big Bang has picked up a couple of veterancy at this point. He's got a potential for 17k health. He does have the T2 upgrade, and he is going to retreat just a little bit. Looks like Artifacts has also thrown down a couple of land factories. Still an unupgraded commander, but he is going to get a hold of all of the reclaim that he can and get a little base of operations up on the front line so he's not left out hanging to dry if anything bad happens. We do have a Notha on the field. That means we got T2 air out. Where we got that? Right there, unassisted, building a T2 engineer at the moment, probably for power. And, oh, wait, what? What? Oh, that's land. Sorry. My bad, people. There it is, building Nauthas, heavily assisted. I know not of what I speak. There is T3 air out for Headphone Guy, though, at 13 minutes, which is a respectably short amount of time for the map of Canis, but unfortunately he is going to dive directly into the heart of the swarm of interceptors there. I see what I did there. And lose one of those ASF. Interceptors do have a respectable amount of damage, actually, if you if you put an air unit in the middle of them. Obviously, they can't catch air units because they're very, very slow versus units at the T3 stage. Gas pumper, why are you doing this? Okay, good. We have mobile flak out, which is going to absolutely shred all of the T2 air in the vicinity, and probably some of the T1 as well, if it will hang around as it is. Poof! And there they all go. The ASF are going to be able to dominate the skies from this point onward, and it looks like only one side has ASF. So this went from a losing battle to something that might actually be brought back. The amount of T2 units, the Ilshavas coming in from the right, is very, very high. That is going to resecure the middle. There's only T1 here, so that is not going to be able to stand a chance in hell against any form of Ilshava. Bet you didn't know there were multiple forms, did you? And then Momo is going to drop the T2 upgrade. So things are looking up. And Headphone Guy is going to get a massive eco since he's the air player and he's already got T3 air. That could be a dangerous combination. Now I really want... Never mind, I'm not going to say it. Because if it happens later in the game, I can make that joke. All right, hoplites galore. Well, things have finally chilled out just a little bit. Looks like we got some pillars on the left-hand side. That would be T2 for Frankie Darlmino. And it looks like he is going for a resource allocation upgrade because that is a hell of a lot of negative on all of his economy statistics. And then ACU's withdrawing from the field as on a couple of different fronts, actually, which does make a bit of sense because we have T3 air, so you want to get into your base, you want to fortify, you want to protect your ACU from any potential strap bombings or snipings or such things. Looks like Headphone Guy is content to just kind of hang out in the water. It's an interesting choice. And here comes the Mantis once again. Artifacts building an exceptionally large amount of land units for someone who is technically supposed to be the rear air support player. There's a T2 shield going down for Q Continuum. I think that is exclusively a strap bomber preventative measure. And there's T3 air. Frankie Darlmino pulling out an ASF from his T3 air factory. That is going to mark the end of the lack of T3 air up there. Hopefully he can get three or four online, because you need, I'd say, with that many ASF, you probably need three to drop a strap bomber before all of your ASF die. So if he can get three or four of those up, that should protect his team from any strap bomber incursions. We do have land problems on the south side, though. Blue is still pretty much mopping the floor with BRS with two. ICOM doing a fantastic job of pressing his advantage wherever he sees it, although he does need to pick up that right there. I think he has a superior... Oh, wow. He must have a lot of support factories. No, he has a lot of HQs, because why build support factories when you can build multiple HQs? It makes sniping harder, right? Right. Jester's moving out, actually doing a respectable amount of damage to all the Zooies coming in, and you know what? Why not? There is not really enough air on the other side to deny, so might as well pop a couple of those buddies out and deal as much damage as possible. Oh, no! TAC launcher attack! I am so glad that got nerfed. Big Bang has dropped the TAC launcher upgrade on his ACU. Beware! Be very wary of leaving your commander standing still when that son of a gun is on the field. There is a tactical defense down for Headphone Guy. That is going to prevent him from being sniped anyway. And here comes the strap bomber. Noth is dropping like flies thanks to those ASF. And the strap bomber is going to cut straight up the middle. Probably going to go after all of the mass extractors that it can possibly get before it dies. There we go. Dropping there. Is that a blue ASF I see? Yes, it is. That means we got two people building air. He's going to get two bombs off. Nope, just one. That was a wide miss on that one. And Headphone Guy is going to directly engage. That looks pretty sketchy. You may have more ASF, but when you've also got that many interceptors on the map, that becomes a little bit more difficult to deny. And Noth is coming in after the T3 P-Gen while all the ASF are over to the left. All the ASF in a box to the left. The hoplites might actually have enough reach to cross the water there. Do they? No, they do not. Not quite. Well, maybe if they're standing right on the edge, but the ACU could take literally three steps and be out of reach. All right, so the PGN was saved, but that was actually a really nice play. I like it when people use a little bit of subtlety to try to strike at a target, because that would have been a fairly decent loss there for Headphone Guy. That would have heavily damaged those three air factories, which meant if he wanted to assist them, he'd first have to heal them. And, of course, the 2,500 power that you're out. Looks like Big Bang is getting harassed by T2 torpedo bombers, but honestly, I'm not too worried because he has a gargantuan amount of health. I don't think that's anything that a couple of T2 torpedo bombers are going to shed anytime soon, especially when he is that close to land on several occasions. Obviously, Aeon torpedo bombers do a pretty dang decent job of landing torpedoes even in shallow water, but after a certain point, even those have their issues. Flak moving up, gonna finally wipe out that vast horde of interceptors. I know I keep saying that that's a huge clump, but seriously, we're at the T3 air stage, and this guy is still fielding like 50 plus interceptors. Well, not anymore, since the Flak took them all out, but you know what I mean. That is just an obscene amount of T1 air to be having on the map at 20 minutes into the game, but you know what? I really can't fault him that much, because it did make a difference in a couple of different air battles, so must be doing something right after all. Looks like we do have a T2 stationary artillery down for a gas pumper. Not entirely sure what that's all about. And yeah, that's not the best positioning for it. I guess he gets a preemptive strike for units moving in, but whatever. Down here on this side, that is a huge group of rhinos. That's a lot of T2, and there is not much resistance there. The rhinos are going to roll over everything in their path, wiping out that entire expansion and moving up. Wow. Also, my panning controls have changed since last time I was in my settings. There's a lot of things that I need to adjust. They're probably going to be heading right in just a few moments to try to invade the base, and I think they're actually going to be relatively successful. There's the reason for the lack of units. It looks like BRS with 2 has actually pushed T3 land. He is going to be getting some loyalists out, which should be able to deal relatively effectively with all of the rhinos over here on this side. Lots of artillery moving down from the north. Not sure that's going to be entirely effective, but hey, anytime you can try, it's the effort that counts. Galactic Colossus going down for Headphone Guy. This is exactly what I was talking about with that large economy that he's fielding. He's got both of these bases down. He's trying to get the first T3 mass extractor down. He has started the Galactic Colossus. Does he have reclaim? I don't think he does. That is interesting. Starting several things at the same time. We've got 135 eco for Headphone Guy and Frankie Delmino. Yes, he has four T3 mechs, almost. Three and a half. Let's go with that. So he is focused on getting a lot of T3 mechs, and he's matching the eco of someone who has way more mechs than he does, which is very, very respectable. So when that Galactic Colossus comes on, it is likely not to be quite as effective as they think it will be, because the north side is actually matching them in economy. If they decide to drop a T4, they can probably get one up before the Galactic Colossus reaches the other side of the map. Not to mention the fact that we are starting to see some Percivals on the field. Not enough yet to stop a Galactic Colossus, but Frankie Darmino is pumping out T3 units at a fairly vigorous pace, so we're just going to have to keep an eye on that. Looks like the Ilshavas were moving back into the base to attempt to stop that little incursion over there, but it was unnecessary. Now we do have all of these rhinos, though, which could pose a very serious problem. Oh, Flak! No! I like the idea. I like trying to reclaim areas, but you can't fly your transport full of engineers over enemy Flak. It just does not work. Looks like those tanks are going to halt for at least just a minute more. So we've got one brick and four loyalists and an artillery. Definitely need a little bit more there to back you up, bud. Some T2 point defense going down. That is obviously not going to hurt, but T2 point defense is not going to stop a group of rhinos of that size. The T3 mobile artillery is doing a pretty good job though, because that large area of effect tearing into the T1 units, you're going to leave some corpses on the battlefield, no doubt about it. There's a T2 stationary artillery facing the wrong direction. We've got flapjacks up on the ridge firing at the firebase. That is where you want your artillery to be pointed. That's the entire point of having that artillery, is to knock out those mobile artillery, or those mobile missile launchers, I am entirely sure. Galactic Colossus is moving off to the left. Question is this going to be a mass donation, or is this actually going to make a difference in how this battle turns out? If he can wipe out this, that would actually be a tremendously valuable target to destroy. So many air. So very many air. And all of its interceptors, just about. Although, the 2-1 in the air game is a little bit brutal. Headphone does have his work cut out for him, because each one of these guys has a respectable amount of ASF. He has a little bit more than either one of them, but combined, they tremendously outnumber him. All right. I really sincerely hope that I'm not getting sick, because that would suck. I have way too much to do this week to get sick. Oh, man. Okay. Galactic Colossus is just going to kind of chill out in the middle here for a minute. Not sure what he's doing exactly. And here comes some T3 movement to the south. We have a raiding party of a lot of Titans, which are going to get met with a lot of Loyalists. Which one of these do you think wins? Well, we all know the Titans are underpowered. I think that's the entire quantity of information that we need to know. Titans falling left and right. There goes, was that a Rhino? I think it was. There goes a Loyalist. Maybe another Loyalist, but good lord, the damage is horrendous to this battle group. Look at that. Ha ha ha. Shrugging off the shots of all of those Titans. Well, they vastly outnumbered that group of Cybern units. They are going to be victorious, but that's a lot more losses than you should have with a clump of T3 meeting another clump of T3. Galactic Colossus moving through the water, trying to get a lock on Big Bang, who is dipping in and out of the water. Is that really a T2? Really now? Really a T2 naval factory? Here comes the broadswords. That is going to deal a huge amount of damage. ASF coming in, sacrificing themselves to try to get rid of a couple of gunships and buy that GC some time. Here's the deal. If that GC can catch the ACU, he can stomp him to death. There it goes. You don't even need the beam. Just walk on him. When was the last time you saw an ACU KO'd by a head kick? That is what's so awesome about the experimentals. They're just big damn units. All right, GC tearing into the group of Percivals now. I don't think he can overcome the amount of damage that is being dealt. He is going to go down, but not before causing tremendous losses and dealing with the front guard ACU. That's pretty much the entire point of that Galactic Colossus. I think that that was a success, even if they lose him right there. The only thing that they need to do is attempt to deny that reclaim to the other team. I don't know if that's entirely possible, though, because they don't have the power to project at the moment. Even extending these units is very, very dangerous, because there's only one anti-air there. Maybe he should ground fire the trebuchet on the wreck. That might be the solution that is needed here. Here come the gunships. Going to, yep, camp out and do a little damage. Well, that took out just about all of the engineers right there. I suppose that's a win. It's going to delay that reclaim for a little bit. Well done. We've got more Percivals moving over to the right. Q Continuum jumping into the T3 production game with a vengeance. And it looks like he is going to lock down the majority of those mass extractors as well. So his eco is only going to get bigger. Looks like our current lead slot for income is indiscernible, because there's people reclaiming Galactic Colossuses, and that is going to throw your eco numbers quite a bit. Somebody needs to get in the air game. Oh, there's a strap bomber. No, the large area of effect is brutal, but why would you bomb the Hydro? That makes no sense. there's a monkey lord coming up. All right, and that is a lot of fire beetles. What all those are for? That's interesting. Okay. So at this exact moment, the southern team made a little bit of a resurgence, but now there's just so many T3 units for the north side. I am not sure that they will be able to hold this. The air problem is a big one. We do have a few ASF online from Momo Uchiha. Hopefully he will go double down on that air production, because if he does not, these guys are going to be outclassed in every way moving forward. There's Flak taking out the last couple ASF on that side. I hear an Ilshiva. There it is right there. This is, Yathotha, not an Ilshiva. That reminds me of my comment earlier. This is my final form! Yes, the Master Chicken Race. The Chikorathi, if you are watching any of the other stuff going on my channel. The intelligent race of chickens from conflicts. Let's see, Monkey Lord moving south. So that is, well, it depends on how you handle it. If you handle your Monkey Lord perfectly and there's no veterancy on the Yathotha, Monkey Lord can fairly easily win versus a Yathotha. But once you start vetting up on this thing, the health starts going up. You start having more and more of a problem versus the Monkey Lords. Alrighty then. This Monkey Lord is about 3/4 finished, so he'll be coming off of the production line fairly soon, and we're still expanding the air production for headphones. And there is a... Is that... No! No! He is going T3 UEF Navy in the middle. Why would you gamble like that, and what could you pop... Well, battleships, I suppose. Oh no. If he starts dropping battleships, that's going to be a 150 range unit that he can park right there in this end. If he can hold it, because obviously any land T4 is going to be able to just walk up to the battleship and pound it to death. For that matter, T3 land units. But if you can protect a battleship or two, you would actually be able to do horrendous damage to the bases using that as a siege weapon. Sorry, guys. I'm going to bow out there for a minute to save your eardrums. Alright, so the Monkey Lord is apparently going to be kept on guard duty, which I don't think is a bad idea, actually. And the chicken has backed off just a little bit. So at the moment, we are in a good old standoff. Still with the Mantis. Holy crap. There comes the Cybern Strap Bomber trying to lay down, well, killing a whopping one T1 land unit. Such efficiency. It's incredible. Strap Bomber winging back away, and many engineers. Lots of build power on this thing. That battleship is going to be out in a very short amount of time. I think at this point we can probably refer to that as the Advanced Fat Boy, which you will only see on the map of Canis. We're going to have a Fat Boy 1.0 crossing the water here. We got a Monkey Lord for front guard and a Fat Boy for artillery support, which is a very, very strong combination. Not the only thing stronger you can have with that is two Fat Boys and two Monkey Lords, but we won't get ahead of ourselves. It's a brutal 4,000 damage under a stealth field, backed up by about 4,000 DPS of gunfire. So, yeah, awesome, awesome stuff. No, wait, hold on, 3,333? No, it's about 4,000 damage per second, I think, from the Fat Boy. One way or another, there are a lot of T4s on the south side as well. We've got one Monkey Lord, two chickens, one with a veterancy. We got a bunch of fire beetles, and we have another Monkey Lord, and then a Megalith and a Monkey Lord started. So that's four T4s with two more in production on the south side, and a literal buttload of T3 land units on the north side with a Fat Boy and a Monkey Lord and almost a UEF battleship. That is something that I have never seen on Canis. Many, many games of Canis have been sent to me. I have played quite a few games on Canis, and I have never seen a UEF battleship on this map. That is just ludicrous. Why is this a thing, and why is the battleship killing a T1 mass extractor, or attempting to, anyway? Well, we were talking about artillery support, and my friends, that is exactly what we have here. Oh no! Mismanagement of the fat boy. Crap. That thing is going to die a horribly painful death. The monkey lord is down, but that still leaves one monkey and two Ilshavas powering up the center. This is not good at all. We've got one battleship online, which is eventually going to be very strong, but it does not deal damage fast enough to stop the advance of a T4 army. This is going to die, I do believe. I don't think there's anything the northern team can do to save it. Monkey Lord diving into Percival Town, which is not necessarily the best place to hang out at night, but he is going to do reasonably well for himself with a little bit of backup from those Yathothas and the help of a veteran seat. 1,000 health. Ooh, yeah, there it goes. It is down. That was the Rambocom at work. Rambocom's going to do pretty well, actually, versus Yathothas, because you can dodge the majority of the damage if you are very, very careful about your micro. Those Yathothas are going to back up. Why the hell are you backing up? You've got two Yathothas versus a single Rambocom with a Monkey Lord soon to arrive. I'm not entirely sure what the dealio is there. There's a Megalith as well. Goodness gracious, how many T4s are these guys going to build? Headphone Guy doing a phenomenal job of seizing air control. Beautiful micro there, falling in behind all of those different groupings. It looks like Gray is sitting on his ASF, so well done, Headphones. You have done a fantastic job of securing that. That's going to allow him to project. We're now going to be able to see restores moving out and good solid air support. Obviously, you got to stay away from the mobile flag, but we're not going to have to worry about all of those potential strap bombers and gunships that would otherwise be shredding your T4s. So much flak fire. So many flak. There we go. That Rambocom hiding out in the water just like that ACU was. Monkey Lord's going to try to get a trample, and not quite. Rambocom is faster, so he's just going to flee the scene, never to be caught again. But that Monkey Lord is a little bit concerning, because if he gets near that battleship, the battleship is obviously going to die. Megalith has dealt with the Athotha. One of them is down, the other is back. That was the fresh-faced Athotha. Megalith trying to get the Monkey Lord before the Monkey Lord can close with the battleship. It is not meant to be. So much health on those battleships, though. Half health, backup Monkey Lord saving the day. The slugfest continues in the middle of this map, but I think that Megalith may be the trump card, but no! We've got another Megalith coming from the south side, quickly to be followed by a Athotha. We basically have a fabrication chain of T4s moving out of both sides. Here comes the second UEF battleship. This is where your damage starts accumulating and this starts getting nasty, because one battleship by itself does not actually have an excessive amount of damage. But once you start getting two or three or four stacked up together, they start being able to drop even T4s like Megaliths reasonably quickly. The artillery support is real. Megalith is going to stand up versus the other. We do have a Monkey Lord in for support. If you have a focus fire and the Monkey Lord coming in, walk, walk. You have to get in there. But nope, that's okay. You can just sit there. That's fine. Oh, there we go. Finally. So I say, just let your comrade die. That's totally okay. But I think those are going to die one way or the other, because that Megalith is toasty fried. This Megalith is going to die, I think, but that Monkey Lord is also going to go down. That's going to leave the southern team with a half-health Yathotha, I do believe. More than half-health, actually. Actually, that was going to be a dodge of the death ball. But the Gatling gun did take it down. You thought that has an obscene amount of damage. When you add all three of the guns together, it just does a load of hurt. That is a lot of spearheads. Apparently he is intent on breaking this fire base at some point. But that is a lot of spearheads. It really is. Kill battleship with the chicken too. Absolutely. There goes a SACU. Unfortunately, the shield is up on that one. But there goes the Athotha punching that battleship in the midriff. Hopefully it will get it down, because they definitely need to get rid of those battleships. Oh, the broadswords coming in. The Athotha is going to get into the water, though. Come on, get your lightning storm up in there. One battleship down. And looks like he is going to go... Oh, saved. Holy crap, that was close. The air control for headphone guy really saved that chicken's butt. Battleship is going to go down. Like 6,000 health survival there from that broadsword assault. 1,000 health, one more connection from this summit, and that chicken is down. But all he has to do is dodge a little bit. The slow-moving battleship projectiles will miss, it is a surety. And there he goes. Percival got the kill shot in. Spearhead fire is brutal, to be sure. There are some Percivals on the south side of the base, which are not being fired at the moment, actually. But yeah, you can see the rain of destruction coming down on that base. We do have Percivals in the base. Been so focused on what's going on in the middle, did not even realize that, hey-o, we've got some T3 action in the base. Unfortunately, those Percivals losing a lot of shots into the hills. Strap bombers coming in, combined blows dropping two of the Percivals, and it looks like we do have some gunships coming in to try to finish up the work, but they're just going to hang out for a minute. Apparently it was time for the coffee break. Break time's over. We are back in business. So one mass extractor lost, not anything too terribly severe. One mass extractor and a T3 P-Gen. So could have definitely been worse overall, about the best that you can ask for with a group of Percivals in your base. All right, so we do have a nuke defense up. We've got a Skathis going up. That is harsh. And a nuke for Gas Pumper. Beautiful. We're about to start seeing some nukes. Megalith and a Athotha there. This was pushed back by a counter assault from Ilshavas, but not before the damage was done to that base. Those Percivals are going to just move in and plunder the base. We got a Fat Boy coming up here. What else have we got in the works? We've got an Omni. We've got a nuke defense that is loaded, so the South's nuke is not going to work. I think that about sums up our game. Megalith moving around to the south side, trying to deal with... Oh, good lord, we have a Monkey Lord. Strap bombers ahoy, though. Doing the dirty deed as quickly as you could ever ask for. Headphone guy has a ton of strap bombers at his disposal. If I was the northern team, I would be worried about snipes right now. Holy cow. Because he has about 15 of those son of a guns, and those can pretty much punch through any shield at that point. And there is not much shielding going on. There is a nuke, which is not loaded. I think it just finished a minute ago. So there's one nuke, and that's all. Still T4 is dropping left and right, though. And those summits, I would have never thought that those summits would get as far as they have. Two SACUs down. Oh no, headphone guy, get up there. Alright. All of those strap bombers could have been killed had the north side been paying attention to the ASF placement there. Oh, and Sam's gutting the middle of that ASF horde. Not what you want to have happening to your T3 air. We've got Percivals under fire from the Ilshava, and a Monkey Lord moving in to stab that in the back. This is exactly the advantage you want as a Monkey Lord versus a Athotha. If you can close range without being fired upon, you basically win. But unfortunately, there is another Monkey Lord coming up the back end, which is about to make contact with the laser. And that is that. Bye-bye, Monkey Lord. So much wreckage. Holy cow. I need to take a look at the reclaim numbers right after this. Do we have a semi-com spot? I would say yes. Let's take a look. Headphone Guy, 74,000. Frankie, 93,000. Gas Pumper with 25. Q Continuum. Oh, wait, hold on. That was ICOM. Gas Pumper with 25. Q Continuum with 23. And we've got 18, 45, 61. 7 and 4 for the dead guys. So yeah, lots of mass has changed hands, and there are still a lot of wrecks out in the middle of this map. There goes another SACU, and the Megalith is going to close enough. Come on, get that summit. You're within reach. You had it. He's only got 2,000 health. Oh well. Gonna go for the support commander instead. Which I suppose I can't totally blame him for, but whatever. We've got another Galactic Colossus coming out for headphones. There goes the other SACU. Need to park the damaged battleship in the back. That would be my suggestion to you, Frankie Darmino. Because typically when you park your damaged assets in the rear, they are less likely to actually die. You can get the full force of the damage for a bit longer, even if you've got a unit that only has a couple of health on it. Skathus, T3 artillery. This is officially in the end game, folks. This is late game, Supreme Commander, and yeah, we can have a lot of different things happen at that point. Never mind, I'm saying things. Okay, we've got one nuke. I was about to say, we're going to have three game enders, but, well, yeah, nuke counts as a game ender. Okay, so that nuke is now loaded, but I would assume they have scouted the nuke defense on the north side and have decided not to launch quite yet. I'm making already nuke ready where to launch. Strategic just launch keep the defense. Nuke. Ooh, there's a nuke. We'll check and see if they have defense in just a second. So there's one nuke, two nuke, three nuke. Do we have any more? I don't think so. So we're about to have three nukes coming up simultaneously on the north side. So we definitely need more defenses on the south end. Do these guys have anti? That is the question. It looks like the answer is no. Gonna nuke right on the edge. Move your freaking commander. Oh, it wasn't loaded anyway. I was about to say. Oh, man. Oh, that's terrible.
Strategic launch detected.
Asking how? Well, that's what happens when your anti-nuke is not loaded and your commander is standing too far away from the anti-nuke. Because you can edge-nuke somebody. Why do you know? They have no defense. They don't have the range. Trying to make sense of the chat over there. It doesn't make much. Alright, nuke coming in over here as well. Is there no loaded anti? Ah, there's one. Beautiful. Shot down. They're going to have to do a little bit more loading, though, because there are a lot of nukes about to come in from the north side. Yulshaba and Monkey Lord trading blows on relatively equal footing. That Monkey Lord is going to go down. And two T4s on the left side to defend as well. Fat Boy's going to go down. Nice, nice. Strat Bombers doing what they do best. That is going to be a secure right-hand side once again. There's an awful lot of Percivals and Flak over there. That is honestly about one of the most terrifying battle groups that you can see. But for now, that is going to be the end of it. Okay. Reclaim is going to happen here. Headphone Guy is going to assimilate another base. And he definitely needs to be getting more anti-nuke up. He's got one that is half-loaded. What have they scouted? That is the question. Most everything, actually. So if they're paying attention, they should know now that there are three nukes on the north side, and one or two nuke defense is not going to cover that. It's just not. They have a loaded anti on their side. That's nice. So those two are about a third. And this one is three quarters of the way to another nuke. All right. Tactical missile launch. Where is that headed? Was that... Did those TAC missiles impact an ASF? I know one of them got shot down by the tactical defense. Protect from telemaser, guys. Very sage advice. I think that was a TAC missile connecting with a parking ASF. Like, it was hovering in the air, getting down, and, yeah. Took out a couple of TAC missiles. That was nice of him. Protecting the naval factory. Got down fairly low, but it was not a successful kill, and now we have three battleships up. Count them, three. I'm actually kind of curious now about the potential damage on that, but I don't have a readout on damage dealt as a statistic. There goes another pass of the TACs. Trying to shoot them all down. Battleship's doing a pretty dang decent job of it. About half health again. It's going to take more than that to punch through. I think those, yeah, they have one or two tactical missile defenses. Two buzzkills, I think, per battleship. Yep, one, two. I'm not sure if they can both fire, though. Maybe, yeah. If the TAC missile's coming over, if they can't fire in a 360-degree pattern, if it's flying over, you're still going to catch both 180s. So, yeah, effectively two buzzkills. Nice, nice. It's like that megalith is single-handedly chasing away three T4s. Well, that is a fearsome megalith to be sure, but I guess when you're also backed up by three summits, it does kind of make sense to run. Although now there's four T4s, so why are you not pressing your advantage versus the megalith? That actually doesn't make sense to me. Let's check out the range on these summits. Yeah, that's a fair bit of reach on this map. If you park there, you can reach like right there. Definitely into the base. Very, very nice. Very, very nice indeed. Alright, Monkey Lord getting slurped up by Q Continuum. It's going to be yet more mass into the coffers of the north side. Let's take inventory here. We've got a loaded nuke, a practically loaded nuke, and an almost loaded nuke. So we could actually see a simultaneous triple launch if these guys coordinate. Then we have a Duke that's about a quarter of the way built. Actually, a fifth of the way, but whatever. Yeah. So as far as endgame planning goes, oh, there's the T3 artillery online. And this is one of the things that I'm looking forward to in the next balance patch. This thing takes almost a minute of game time to turn around, I think. It's like 40-something seconds. So, artillery default builds facing south. So that gives the north side a tremendous advantage if they're building artillery at the same time, because this will get several shots off before this one even gets turned around. But they're actually changing that in the next patch, if I'm not totally mistaken, to where the artillery, point defense, whatever, it builds automatically facing the closest unit or the center of the map. And the T3 artillery, I think, defaults towards the center of the map. So that is going to be awesome. It will greatly increase the usability of the T3 artillery, you know, like as soon as it's been produced. So all of those T4s have been wiped out. Sorry, I wasn't totally focused on that battle. The permanent vision definitely helps from ICOM. And those three summits, the Fat Boy and the Megalith, which very nearly died but did not, were enough to take out all of these units. Once you get all those battleships up and about, makes it very, very difficult to deny that much focused damage. It is quite brutal. That T3 artillery, let's see where it's focused at. Looks like it is going for The Mass Fabricators? That's a strange target. I would be going for anti-nuke. Maybe he wasn't aiming it. Who knows? There's a different shot. Where is he going? Directly for the anti-nuke, I think. Good deal. That's what you want to be doing. If you can kill that anti-nuke, that means that you can drop your own. There's the first launch. Means we're probably going to get some more to follow very, very soon. One anti-loaded. No anti-loaded. One anti-loaded. So they're going to be able to stop these two. Question is, can they stop number three? I don't think so.
Strategic launch detected.
Ah. All right, that one's empty. There's a nuke launching there. So many nukes! Goodness gracious, great balls of fire. We get a really lucky arty shot. If both of those hit... Nope, it's not going to work. Crap. Here comes the nuke in for Gray, and oh, there's another anti in the back. Where is it? Yes! All of the anti-nuke is empty, but they succeeded in dropping all of the nukes, and there we go. So many nukes, and all of them are to no effect. There's three loaded in this defense here. If they can kill that, well, two. There were three. If they can kill that, this is pretty much going to be unprotected. So, definitely need... Oh, there it goes! Oh, that's not good. Where... I don't think there are any more. If they were relying on only one, that is going to be a bad time. Alright, Fatboy is in danger of going down. We do have a Yathotha closing in fast. Strap Bombers dealing with the summits. That Megalith is obviously dead. So this is turning once again. Anywhere now, both antis down. Try to kill White. That would be smart. Because he has one of the better developed ecos. And he also has all of the Navy units and all of this ridiculous mess. Strap Bombers coming in. Going for the eco. Actually doing a fairly respectable job. And there goes another nuke. Where is this one headed? Right dead center for the middle of White's base. Pretty much the last place you want a nuke. There's a Duke on the north side, which is going to be taken out by that launch. Duke shots are landing on the... Yes, on the emissary. Okay, so that is going to remove the T3 artillery as an issue. Unless we get some freak occurrence here. Wouldn't it suck if a T3 artillery shell collided with a nuke? That's actually... That was actually reasonably close, but whatever. Anyway, here comes the nuke. The White ACU, I think, is going to escape. Why does no one have anti except me? Well, Orange did, and it got sniped. There goes the White base. The economic powerhouse is down. There's a Megalith coming around the base, but I think there's enough Strap Bombers to deal with it. The Yathotha is cleaning up on this side. There's an obscene amount of Rambo presets on this side, which could easily kill that Yathotha, actually, if they just come out of the water. It looks like they're mostly there for reclaim duty. And the two summits will be dog food soon enough if those Strap Bombers can turn their attention. Well, actually, there's only four left. Ooh, these guys need something to deal with this. Very, very quickly. 65,000 health on a Megalith, and it's got to be dead now. Come on, come on. What you gonna do? What you gonna do when Megalith comes for you? 54, and no! Strap Bomber's gonna get lost to the ASF there. This keeps getting worse. Hang in there, guys. Rambo comms going to take down that Yathotha, no problem whatsoever. Reclaim! Nope. Lightning Storm. If you reclaim the Yathotha, it will not drop the Lightning Storm after it dies. But that was a missed opportunity right there. There goes a SACU. Still 48,000 health on that Megalith. Thankfully, there are a buttload of shields here and more shields going up. Actually, shields going up faster than the Megalith can deal damage. There's Mercy's coming in. 39,000 health. It's going to walk into the reach of the T2 point defense. Why is the T2 point defense not firing? It's in sight. What is this madness? More Rambo comms dying. There we go. We got a focus fire now. That Megalith is going to go down. There are plenty of T2 point defense there. Those Oblivion turrets are going to do ludicrous amounts of damage. And down goes Mr. Megalith. One more shot. Boom. Now we have an entirely different problem. Rambo comms moving into the base. Headphone guy desperately needs to protect that T3 artillery because that's pretty much the only thing left going for them. Percival's moving in as well. The Athatha moving around the outside edge, playing ring around the rosies with all of these support commanders that are coming in. The rest of the map looks awfully bad for the south side. Ugh. Rambo comms moving over to the right hand, it looks like. That is going to bring them closer to the Athatha, which is good. Mercy's pounding away at all of these units. Strap bombers coming in as well. You're in my airspace now, bitch. Die. And, oh man, Rambo comms exploding left and right. Shields are down. Is that a gray strap bomber from the north side coming in to throw insult to injury? And I can't even see because the nuclear fire is relatively persistent. The strat defense is about to get shanked. No, SACU dying before it can connect. That was actually close on the friendly fire, but it did not die. Rambocom number two going to take out the defense before it dies. We've still got one nuke, two, and three intact with two of them loaded. So that strat defense is down. What do we got here? We've got zero loaded. We've got dead. We've got dead. Oh no. There's no nuke defense left. Ah!
Strategic launch detected.
Alright, so there's a launch. That artillery has been pounding away, but we've just been too distracted. There's no nuke defense. Repeat, there is no nuke defense. It's close, but it's not there. Nuke coming in for the impact. They're both loaded. Oh, they're launching.
Launch detected.
One is going to get launched. Can the second one launch?
Strategic launch detected.
Second one. Oh, there's three. And, it got out of the silo. No! Three nukes, triple nuke for the completion. Oh, good lord. And they're all separately targeted, I think. There is no defense. That is there's one. One just barely got out. There's a nuke on purple. He is going to get his ACU out alive, but not much else than that. And then a nuke taking out the entirety of Gray's base as well, with a significant portion of gas pumpers going down. That looks... Oh, man, that looks bad. That looks very, very bad. We've got a Megalith and a Athatha and more Reclaim than anyone could ever know what to do with. Who needs Eco? We got Reclaim. Well, power could be... The emissary lives! It lives! Get shields over it. Keep it alive. And we still got a T3 PGen over there. Okay, so if these guys reclaim like all hell and build more T4s and maintain air control, this is a lot of ifs. They may still be able to get this pulled out. Gas pumper throwing out. Well, GG, fellas. You know, I don't think it's an option because there is another nuke here, which is about to launch and is about to have a second one loaded. The guys have no defense. The artillery is awesome, but I don't think it can do what they need it to actually win this. There goes a T3P gen. If they had attacked this, they might could have gotten that nuke before it launches, but apparently he's just sitting on it for now, which is kind of weird. There goes the artillery shot. All it's going to take is one connection, and the Aeon artillery is, of course, brutally accurate. Very effective. Megalith is going to kill the Athotha there. And... oh, man. That was about as close as you can possibly get and not actually hit it. Not sure where that Megalith's headed. Second shot. And... it's... not good. Wow. How is this being so perfectly spaced? Like, you're trying to kill one thing, just one little thing, and somehow you just keep missing it. Literally could not hit the broadside of a barn. And there it is. The nuke cluster is down. Headphone guy saying, but I have no air. Yes, this is a problem, because pink and blue are forcing out as much air as they possibly can, along with Megalith. I think that I would actually be prepared to throw in the GG at this point, because I don't see how these guys can come back. They're all going to get strat sniped, and that is going to be the end of it. That was a brutal game. Good lord. And some of the tactics used. I've never seen battleships on Canis. That is a new one to me. And it actually worked a lot better than I thought it would. Especially down here on the right-hand side where those four T4s were killed off by the combined firepower of a Megalith and three battleships. Fantastic work. Well, a couple of Rambo comms and some other things thrown in there. But the majority of it was three battleships and a Megalith. And then all of the other stuff that went on in here, barring, well, a telemaser. Gray could theoretically pull off a telemaser. I think that is going to be it. There's an ACU. There's an ACU. He is underwater, though, so no telemaser there. Yeah. Man, the T3P gens are just disappearing left and right. Here comes Megalith in the base. There is a Athotha still. Frankie yelling, wait for both Megaliths. Don't lose only one, because then they might come back again. Keep gifting them reclaim. Megalith moving into town. Headphone guy did get another P-gen up, so he's got maximum fire rate on that T3 already. But like I said, it just can't kill enough. Cannot kill enough. It's a valiant effort, and he has done a lot of damage. But one T3 artillery cannot compete versus an entire team. There's two Yathothas out now, which could actually stand a chance versus a Megalith. But with two Megaliths, the damage is just too damn high. T3 P-gens going down still from that T3 artillery. All right, we need to end this, folks. The long death spiral. Just ram those Megaliths up in there and kill a commander. That's all you got to do. There's one right... oh, nope, that's an SACU. Sorry! There's one right there. There's one right there. The carnage is real. Megaliths have got a turn. There we go. Kill that son of a gun. And, of course, Lightning Storm. But whatever. The amount of damage that two Megaliths can do is just so high. It is a fearsome weapon with good range. More than a match for just about anything else. And that one Megalith is going to go down to the Lightning Storm, I think. Or the Strap Bomber one. Strap Bomber! Yep. Couple of Strap Bombers. But now there is a Monkey Lord in the base as well. Was that? Yes, that was a GC trying to drop that monkey, which is actually going to get dropped by Oblivion turrets. Oblivion too strong. All right, headphones, you got the commander shield. I want to see you go overcharge a megalith to death. Dun 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 dun. Daba daba. Okay, yeah, that is Mission Impossible. He may get close enough to fire a couple of shots, but I don't think there's any way that he can overcharge a megalith to death. I mean, technically, he could get underneath it, maybe, but nope. Caught up in the warm embrace of Oblivion. Alright, guys, Control K, take it with dignity, because at this point, we all know how this is going to end. You can build all the Ilshivas that you want. Why do I keep calling them Ilshivas? Stop it, brain. Stop it. You can build all of the Athothas that you want. The Megaliths are still going to win. Longest Canis game ever. Yes. 1 hour and 2 minutes at this moment. Longer than most settings. That is true. That last nuke missed most of my production, but my P-gens chain-sploded. Here goes Gas Pumper. The demonic star of the Seraphim explosion. And, who's left? Gray. Right there. Come on, Momo. Accept your fate. I want to see you die to torpedo launchers. Oh, am I going to get my wish? I'm going to get my wish. Nope, Monkey Lord's coming online. It's going to demolish those torpedo launchers. No! What is going to kill him? Well, there's two Megaliths coming in, so one way or another, he is dead. The vastly superior build power. Well, no, actually, there are several SACUs. That's a problem. The Megaliths are going to win out on that one. Here comes the T2 torpedo launchers. It's going to force that commander out on this side. Stealth generator to try to stop it. That's actually a good idea, but the T3 spy planes are OP. And the SACUs are falling. There goes the commander. That is it. 1 hour, 4 minutes, and 23 seconds. Almost got a 420 in the clock. Dang it. Alrighty, guys. That was the Epic Canis. Good lord, that was a long game. I need to go to bed now. Alright. As always, thank you guys so much for watching. Please, if you have any good replays, send them over to me. I definitely am always in need of material to keep these casts coming to you every single week. If you're watching this on Tuesday afternoon, do not forget that I am streaming 1v1 ladder tonight at 6 p.m. Eastern United States time. Depending on how I feel, I'm recording this the day before. I am going to try to do it, but I may perform even more poorly than usual for your entertainment, depending on how my brain is coping at the moment. But anyway, we will do that, and I will see you guys in the next one.